Are you confused by the statin statistics out there and how they may apply to you? Well, if you are, you're not alone. That's the subject of this week's video. Stay tuned. Before I get started on the main topic here, I just have an important point to make, so it can be embodied in this question. What is the name of your cardiologist or other cardiovascular specialist? Kind of a trick question. The point really is if you answered it with a doctor's name, then there's a reason you're under that doctor's care. It's most likely that you're a high-risk patient. Either you have known cardiovascular disease or you've actually had an event, a heart attack or a stroke. So you really need to work with that doctor. A lot of what I say in these videos are really geared towards and aimed at people who are being browbeaten into taking statins as primary prevention. I'm not going to go there when it comes to secondary prevention. You really do need to listen to your cardiologist. If you turn out to be statin intolerant, then please work with your medical professional to find suitable treatment alternatives. My videos are basically not intended to second guess the doctors of high risk patients. And I really hate to use the term second guess because it sounds like I'm saying I am second guessing your primary care physician. No, I'm actually asking you to just have information that you can clarify with them. For example, I want to help all patients be better informed, and I want to also provide support and encouragement for those people who have been harmed by statins, because that's a lot of people. Literally, could be millions. That may be a small number compared to all the people on statins, but it's a large number when it comes to your personal experience. Now, you should also verify anything you hear on this channel, if you decide that is valid for you, with your doctor. For example, one viewer noted on my CoQ10 video that their doctor, their cardiologist, had said they shouldn't be taking CoQ10 because of a particular interaction with some other drug. That's obviously something that from a general discussion we can't know, and the doctor has no vested interest in telling a patient not to be on CoQ10. So if they're saying don't be on it, then there's probably a legitimate reason behind it. So let's get into it. Population statistics versus individual decisions. I've talked about that a lot. I've said, in my opinion, population statistics don't apply to individuals. So we're going to talk about that first. And let's forget about statins for the next 3 or 4 minutes and just pretend we're in some town, Idealville, where there is an eccentric philanthropist, and he's a mathematician, and he's running a raffle. And the rules of this raffle are he's going to sell 10 tickets for $1 million each. And then one of those 10 tickets is going to be selected, and that person is going to win $15 million because this philanthropist wants to put $5 million into the town's population. He wants to do it his way, and he wants people to have a stake in it. Well, the expected value, this is a mathematical term, of a ticket before the drawing is $1.5 million. Very simple equation here. In other circumstances, the expected value calculation is a little more complicated, but here everybody has a ticket that has a 1 out of 10 chance of being selected, so it's a very simple calculation. The ticket is, in theory, before the drawing, worth more than it costs because it's kind of got a face value of $1 million, but it's worth $1.5 million in theory, according to the expected value. Problem is, nobody's going to get $1.5 million. They're either going to get zero or they're going to win the whole $15 million. So do you buy a ticket? The population statistic choice is yes. I mean, the population as a whole is benefiting. The population is going to start out with $10 million put up and they're going to get $15 million back. The individual choice, it really depends on your situation. If you don't have $1 million, you're not going to buy a ticket. If all you have, say you've been saving all your life for retirement and you have that $1 million and you say, yeah, I can live on this between that and Social Security and that gives me a comfortable retirement. Oh man, but $15 million? We could do everything we wanted. We could finance the grandchildren's education. We could go on trips and everything. But if I lose that $1 million that I struggled so long to save, I'm going to be essentially destitute. And there's a 90% chance that that's going to happen and only a 10% chance that I'm going to win. So in that circumstance, you also probably wouldn't buy one of these tickets for $1 million. That's too risky. We can contrive examples where a person may actually put up $1 million. I mean, if they have millions and millions and millions, yeah, and they might take a risk. If they owe somebody $15 million, it's a loan shark and they're going to get killed if they don't pay them off and they've only got $1 million, well, okay, you know, it's an act of desperation, you might buy it. But the point is, this population statistic is very clear. The population is going to gain $5 million if they just participate in this, but the individuals aren't. So that's why the individual choice is very different than the population choice. So what's the point of this little thought exercise? Well, population statistics need to be either overwhelmingly favorable or the cost incredibly low for most people that they feel it's worth the risk. Example of a low cost is a lot of people buy a dollar lottery ticket or $2, whatever it is, where the payoff is, say, $200 million, 1 in a billion chance that you're gonna win. Well, their expected value of that ticket is 20 cents on a dollar. Doesn't make sense. But hey, for something that costs so little pain to dream a little bit and to know that somebody may win, yeah, people may do it because the cost is low. This is actually what's behind why when clinicians only look at population statistics, they totally miss the point when it comes to individual decisions. A population statistic is not the main basis for individual decisions. That should be framed above every doctor's desk so they can read it every day. So what's this got to do with statins? Well, we have this statement we hear all the time.
Benefits outweigh the risks.
But that's actually a statement about population statistics. It's not necessarily pertinent to individual decisions. It can figure into the individual decision, but it's not going to be the big driving force for most people. For example, a double-digit NNT, that's a number needed to treat, which is what we get out of these population statistics, it doesn't impress most patients. The risk, which is a financial cost, inconvenience, you know, taking a pill every day, remembering to take it. Adverse effects at all levels, minor to deadly. I mean, there are sometimes deadly adverse effects of statins in a lot of drugs. You even see that on TV. In rare conditions, death may occur. You know, if death occurs, see your doctor immediately. So these have to be weighed against the benefits on a case-by-case basis. So what is the cardiovascular risk for the patient? That's one of the things we have to consider, and that's by the calculators or whatever exceptional circumstances they have. And by the way, those risk calculators that I talk about a lot, those do not consider people who already have cardiovascular disease or have already had an event such as a heart attack or a stroke. In other words, they don't include that in the calculation. They are really for primary prevention. If you have one of those conditions, you either already have known cardiovascular disease or you've actually had an event and you're under the care of a cardiologist, yeah, don't bother with the calculators as much. They're really not going to give you meaningful information because of that built-in assumption that you're just an average Joe who just wants to know what his risk is and you don't have known disease. If you are on primary prevention, though, you might want to ask, well, how does this compare to the overall mortality for my age? I had one viewer point out to me that he had a 20% heart attack risk, and because of his age, he had a 50% risk that he's not going to be around in 10 years anyway. Well, yeah, that's something that works into this. As a matter of fact, we'll get to that in a little while. So we have to ask, how are we going to monitor for adverse effects? In some cases, you may say, well, I don't know what the adverse effects are going to be. I've never been on this. The numbers look like I could reduce risk. I might give it a try. But information may change. You may find as time goes on that you have the adverse effects and now you got to rethink it. And we have to ask, well, what amount of adverse effects are tolerable? I mean, there are some minor adverse effects. To take an absurd example, suppose taking any medication caused you to sneeze twice a day. You probably put up with something like that. But if it's going to give you rhabdomyolysis, well, that's deadly and you have to get off it. So we each have to decide what's tolerable for us. I found these side effects to be intolerable. Maybe other people experiencing the exact same thing that I did would find them tolerable. I don't know. That's just the way I am. Next, we're going to just look at an excerpt from a quick little paper. There'll be a link in the description about predicting 10-year mortality for older adults. And this is what I was talking about. I'm just going to direct this to this third paragraph in this final comment. And that is patients identified by this index. Apparently, this paper, they were talking about some index that predicted the probability that an elderly patient was going to die within the next 10 years. Patients identified as having a high risk of 10-year mortality may be more likely to be harmed by preventive interventions with long lag times to benefit. Now, they weren't talking specifically about statins. They were just talking about generally all sorts of therapies or it could be drugs that patients are put on. And they're saying that, well, if the patient is like very high risk, what's the point in making them miserable in the few years that they have left? That's kind of a fatalistic attitude. I was surprised to see it in this paper, but I can see the logic behind it. And then they go on to say, whereas patients identified as having a low risk of 10-year mortality may be good candidate for such interventions. That seems counterintuitive to me. If your risk is very low, well, then we're going to throw drugs on you to make it even lower. Well, if it's already relatively low, but another example of why it's so hard. Everybody's got to make their own decision. So what needs to happen here? Well, more research is needed to better understand the true risks and the true benefits for individuals. Not for populations as a whole, but for individuals. That's the key word here. Using population statistics, it's not good enough unless the statistics are enough to say, well, 100% of patients in your position will have a bad outcome. Well, yeah, if the population statistic is that strong, then yeah, you can use it. What we end up saying a lot of times is, well, 7.5% of the patients in your position have a bad outcome. well, what can I do with that? That's a 1 in 15 chance. It's like, that's not really giving me a whole lot of information. We need more complete characterization. I mentioned this actually in my previous video, of what the true risks are. And again, I've mentioned artificial intelligence and machine learning may be the only way. And even independent of statins, some people objected, well, statins don't do any good anyway. Okay, if that's how you feel, that's how you feel. But identifying people who are truly at risk, like at 100% risk versus 0% risk, is still important for deciding how we're going to treat them, whether it's drugs or it's going to be exercise or it's going to be diet restrictions or whatever it is. It would be really useful to have a bimodal distribution where we can say your risk is either very high or very low, not something in between. Like I said, 7.5% is just not something I can really work with at the individual level. So I know this is idealistic, but what I'm looking for is if you have a room of people like this, instead of saying, hey, overall, there's a 7.5% chance that you're going to have a heart attack in the next 10 years. Instead, we want to be able to really break it out so that 93.5% of the room is told, yeah, you're not going to have a heart attack. And the other 7.5% says, yes, you are going to have a heart attack if we don't intervene and do something, whatever the treatment may be. So I know that's a little idealistic. You know, maybe you can't achieve 0% on one side and 100% on the other, but you could do some other figures that make more sense to us. So that's why it's very difficult to apply population statistics to individuals. Everybody has different values that they'll bring to the table. Everybody has different risk levels that may apply to them. And everybody has just different life situations that they have to deal with. So just using a population statistic that says the relative risk reduction using statins is 36%, you have a 7.5% chance of a fatal heart attack in the next 10 years, it just doesn't do much for us. We have to dig deeper on each individual, and that's what doctors really need to do. Instead of just following blindly some standard of care, my position always is, I understand, doc, you have to follow the standard of care, but I'm under no obligation to follow a standard of care. In any case, if you appreciate this content, please like, share, subscribe, and comment on this topic or others you'd like me to cover. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.